Hello, I'm Jamie Machek with the Wisconsin Valley Library Service, and welcome to our Digital Byte. This is the third part of our series on customer service best practices. So let's go ahead and get right into it. For this Byte today, we're going to talk about phone and email tips. What are some best practices when we're talking with patrons or colleagues or library customers over the phone, as a lot of us do? Or if we're interacting with them over email. We talked about this in the last two trainings, and I encouraged you to think about what does great service mean to you? And this should be something always in the forefront of your mind. Maybe it's something all of you have at your library, maybe it's something part of your library's mission statement, and I encourage you to keep it short and sweet, 10 words or fewer. So if this is your first time watching a digital bite, go ahead and think about that. If it's something you've already thought of, that's great. Maybe give yourself a little bit of a reminder. And last time, in the last digital bite, when we talked about body language, I shared what it means to me. This is 9 words, in case you're counting. And what I want to do every time with my customers, and my customers are our member librarians in the Wisconsin Valley Library Service. I always want to try to exceed expectations whenever I can. I want to be timely, and I always want to treat people with kindness. And I try to do these things not just in my work life, but in my personal life as well. We also talked about the 4 Ps in customer service, right? These are the promptness, politeness, professionalism, and personalization. And every interaction in customer service in our library should have one of these characteristics. If we can incorporate 2 or 3 or all 4 of them, even better. And that, so we have the promptness. Are we doing things in a timely manner? People want things on time. Are we being polite? Are we saying hello? Are we saying goodbye? Are we saying thank you for coming to the library today? Are we being professional? Are we treating everybody with courtesy? Are we treating everybody with respect? And are we personalizing our service? Are we using somebody's name when we know somebody's name? Are we recommending books or items when they ask us to make recommendations? We have the ability in the library, because we're so community focused, to really personalize our service. And that's an advantage that we really do have, I believe. Okay, so let's go ahead and start with some best practices and some tips for when we're on the phone. What is one thing we can do? We don't want to have a script by our phone, and we don't want to sound scripted. I'm sure many of us, when we call a customer service line, whether it's for shoes or for an airline, and we're put on hold, or maybe we want to cancel a cell phone service or a cable service, we can tell when the person on the other end, and maybe they're even from another country, we can tell when they're reading a script, right? And we don't like that because it doesn't feel personal. So we don't want to sound scripted. However, we do want to anticipate what kinds of questions we might be getting. So if there's a bad weather day, or if you're getting a lot of snow in your community, and your phone starts ringing at the library, what kind of question might you be getting? You might be asking if the library is open. You might be asking if the library is going to be closed early. You might be getting asked if the program in the afternoon or the evening program, is that still happening? So we can anticipate. If we need to make little cheat sheets and put them by our phone, that's completely acceptable. And we just want to make sure that we don't sound scripted. And anticipating is really a great thing to do. I do believe this is effective. You might laugh at me, and I'm going to demonstrate this. I'm going to grab my cell phone here. Excuse me. So I'm gonna pretend I'm answering my phone. I'm going to do it with a smile, and then I'm gonna do it without a smile. So let's try the first way. Wisconsin Valley Library Service, this is Jamie. Let's try that again with a smile. Wisconsin Valley Library Service, this is Jamie. Did you hear that difference? When I had a smile or forced myself to smile, my voice automatically and the inflection in my voice automatically went up in pitch. and I sounded more pleasant. It does make a difference when we answer with a smile. In the past, if I've had a not very good day or I'm having a bad morning, we talked about this in the last digital bite, that our customers don't care if we're having a bad day. They care, however, they still want great service. They expect great service from us. So we have to do whatever we can to put our best face forward, to put on our game face when we show up at work. It's the same thing with answering the phone. If you're not having a great day, if you're having a horrible morning, if you need to, grab a post-it note and put smile. Write down smile and stick it by your phone. I know that sounds silly. I've done it in the past and it's worked. If that's what you need to do, then do it. And we want to try to answer with a smile whenever we can. We also want to minimize the silence. Why? Because it's uncomfortable. If we're on the other end of a conversation and we're calling a company or Amazon or an airline and there's silence, we don't like it, right? We're not sure what they're thinking. We're not sure if we lost the call or the call was dropped. So make some small talk with the person who's calling. Maybe you're looking something up on the computer and it's slow. And it's okay to say that. Oh, my computer's thinking. Oh, we're having some great weather today, aren't we? Oh, isn't it nice to see the sun out? So make some small talk and minimize that silence. It'll just put your customer at ease. When possible, we want to avoid transferring. I know this is difficult if you're in a large library with multiple floors and you might not know if somebody is at their desk. However, if you're in a smaller library and if you can see somebody is at a desk or a counter or in the children's area, try to make sure somebody is there before you transfer. If you know somebody is out of the office, you can ask the person, well, Julie is on vacation. She will be here Friday. Would you like her voicemail? That way you're giving the customer the choice. But the less we transfer people around, the better. We also want to make sure we pass along information. So let's say Frank calls us and he received an overdue notice through his email, but he returned a book and he has to speak to somebody else. It's important for us to tell that person why Frank is calling, if we can. That way, Frank doesn't have to explain it all over again. It's more convenient for Frank. He doesn't have to reiterate everything. And it just makes for a better customer service experience. This is really important, especially if somebody is not happy. If they want to speak to a manager or the director, and we can sense that maybe something, the conversation is not going to be pleasant. Any information that we can get ahead of time and pass along to that person is great. We talked about personalization, right, as being one of the four P's of customer service. Great to use even over the phone. You know, use somebody's name. If we can't remember what their name is, we say, and what is your name? Instead of, you know, what was your name? Because whatever was their name likely still is their name. What is your name? If you can't understand, you ask them to repeat it one time. And sometimes it can be hard to hear people over the phone. Sometimes there might be a bad connection. A lot of names sound similar. Carrie, Mary, Larry, Gary, etc. So then we ask them, could you spell that for me, please? And whenever we can use somebody's name, it just makes that call more personal. Before we hang up the phone, we want to end with two things. The first thing we want to end with is, did I answer your question? You know, did I help you the way you wanted to be helped? We're giving them the chance to maybe say to us, well, actually, no, there was something else I needed. So we're asking them if we help them, if we answered their question. And then we're asking, is there anything else I can help you with today? And the today is important because it's letting them know you have my full attention right now. I'm on the phone with you. I want to take care of your needs right now. Is there anything else I can help you with today? Just saying, is there anything else I can help you with is still fine. How do we take that to the next level? Is there anything else I can help you with today? Okay, so we talked a little bit about some phone best practices. So let's go into email. Right off the bat, I want to talk about two things. One of them is the 30-second email. And this was a concept that I heard from Deborah Hamilton. And I saw her present at PLA many years ago, and she talked about this concept, and I really liked it. And the idea is every email that we send to somebody, now there will be exceptions, however, for the most part, every email we send to somebody should be read and understood in 30 seconds or less. If it's more than 30 seconds, then it deserves a phone call or a face-to-face conversation. And I really like that concept because it helps us from getting into very convoluted emails when we should be having a conversation. We should also think of email as doing one of three things: to inform, to ask, to need. So to inform might be telling your staff, hey, the electricians are coming in to replace the light on Friday. The front entrance will not be usable for an hour. Okay, you're informing them of something, right? To ask, could you get me the board minutes from last week by Friday? You're asking something. And then to need. So I need a copy of what you sent out in the mail last week. I need something from you. All of our emails should also fall under one of those three categories. If it's something else, if it's something more personal, something more negative, we're going to look at that slide in a second. It really doesn't belong in an email. So what should emails not cover? Our emails shouldn't have anything negative. We shouldn't be complaining or even venting in an email, and we shouldn't be defensive. There's the old saying, if you wouldn't say something to someone's face, you probably shouldn't put it in an email. Same with social media. So these are things that should not be in an email at all. We want to think of email as being short and covering on one of the three things that we just talked about. So let's talk a little bit more about content. We want to make sure the words we're using are appropriate. So that includes no off-color jokes. I would even include things like smileys or emoticons, unless we know the person. But in a professional email, someone we're writing to for the first time or maybe second or third time, we don't want to use the smileys and emoticons because it's not professional. We want to avoid all caps, as we know, because that comes across as shouting. And I also would encourage you to not use excessive exclamation points. There are some marketing workshops out there on just not using exclamation points at all. And they really aren't necessary in our writing. And like the all caps, they can come across as like we're yelling or being forceful. So we really don't need to use them in our writing or in our email at all. We always want to make sure that we personalize our message, especially if we're contacting somebody for the first time. Hello, Sarah. Hi, Tim. Hi, Larry, or good afternoon, Larry. I always use a formal greeting and someone's first name until that person doesn't anymore. When that person feels comfortable to just write to me, then I take that as a cue that it's okay for me to do that as well. But when in doubt, we want to use formality. So we talked about this in the first digital byte about using positive language. And in that byte, I talked about how it's okay to admit a mistake. It's okay to apologize. We don't want to say it multiple times. What does that do? When we focus on the I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, and we say it several times, and this is no different in writing, our customer or our reader, in this case with an email, is going to focus more on the mistake and instead of what we're doing to correct the mistake. Also, too many I'm sorry's after a while can seem insincere. So we say it one time, we acknowledge the mistake, and then we move on. Most people at the library or out at a restaurant or when we're working in customer service, most people want to be heard. They want you to show compassion. They want you to show that empathy. They want you to acknowledge that we made a mistake. And then they want to know what we're going to do to fix it. So we say it one time and then we move on. We also want to use definitive words. Words like hopefully, kind of, sort of, actually. They're just not very definitive. They're not very confident sounding. Even something like contact me, you know, contact me about this. Okay, so what does that mean? That's pretty vague. Do you want the person to call you? Do you want the person to email you? When you're sending out even a poll to do a survey, you know, those come our way quite often. You know, please complete this poll as soon as possible. Okay, what does as soon as possible mean? For me, as soon as possible means by the end of the day. For someone else, it might mean by the end of next week. So we want to be as specific and as definitive as we can. Let's talk a little bit about how we send bad news. And it's something we don't always want to do or like to do, but it is something that is necessary. One thing we want to do is what we call sandwiching the bad news. So we want to start an email with a pleasant opening. We want to be direct and give the bad news. And then hopefully we can offer a possible solution and then we close pleasantly. So instead of coming right out and giving a customer the bad news right off the bat, we're not trying to be fake here, but we do want to start with a pleasant opening. You know, thank you for contacting us. Thank you for your question. You know, this is the news I'm sharing with you. Here's a possible solution. We're gonna try this, or would this work for you? And then we're gonna close pleasantly. So that's a formula I use when I need to send an email sharing news that someone might not have a good reaction, or we consider it bad news. So that concludes our digital bite on customer service best practices using phone and email. I hope you found it informative. If you have ideas for digital bites, please contact me on trainings you'd like to see. We're happy to take suggestions and we'll get started on working on some of those. So again, thank you for listening and have a great rest of your day. So long.